Hello everyone, just a quick word from your friendly editor slash husband. For all of you who listen to So I'm Watching This Show and own an Android device, do me a favor. Go to the Google Play Store and download the Podcast Republic app. It's a fantastic app that allows you to get all of your favorite podcasts directly on your Android devices. I use the app and love it. I can search for the podcasts I want to listen to, select them as favorites, and have them all just a click away. Make sure you set So I'm Watching the Show as a favorite so you don't miss any new episodes. Again, the app is Podcast Republic, available on your Android device. Thanks!
I was going to talk about the murder bees.
Oh, the wasps?
The murder hornets, yeah.
Or hornets, yeah, okay.
Which is worse.
Yeah, it's all, every iteration is worse.
They're all the rage. They're taking North America by storm. And
yeah, today is the first I've heard of them.
Yeah, well, they breached. this is our fault for doing Starship Troopers, but...
Yikes.
Yeah, for the first time ever in North America, there's apparently like 20 of them in Washington State, and they take over honeybee hives and cut their heads off with their teeth.
Jesus Christ!
They can do it in like a half hour, and they have a sting that feels like hot metal going into you.
I'm just seeing red hot thumbtacks being driven into my flesh. Good Lord. No, thank you.
Yeah. Patton Oswalt said, murder hornets, sure thing, 2020. Give us everything. Hypno frogs, fecal blizzards, toilet tsunamis, a cat sequel. We'll take it.
Look, I mean, at this point, I'm fine with it.
And then TJ Chambers was like, I was really hoping for mail fraud butterflies, but I guess murder hornets it is. So
this person, Matthew Gertz, says read the room, murder hornets.
So just amazing. Wait till they get in your eyes.
No, thank you.
Remember the eye bees? Simpler times.
I do. I'm all set with bugs. I guess now's as good a time as any to just be staying inside. Patton Oswalt's brother said 2020 is like the fourth sequel to a superhero franchise the studio quickly releases before losing the rights. I honestly thought you were going straight into the Buffy theme song.
That's my soul. Herc was on a roll. Person of the week in every Greek opinion bowl. What a pro. Herc. I know it all. I'm just going to sing the entirety.
Yeah, I don't know that
entirety.
Much of it.
He was not one. A zero. Zero. Now he's a honcho. He's a hero.
This is not going to be a fun episode for anybody if you keep doing this.
Major Hulk. I love the and this perfect package back to bear pretty fast. Oh, yeah. So hello, everybody. I am Will.
And I'm Kristen.
And this is So I'm Watching This Show. And on today's episode, we are going to talk about Disney's Hercules. And I know what you're thinking. You're thinking that we pulled this out at the last minute. And we did. However, it was on the schedule before they announced that they were going to do a live action Hercules version, which if you are a longtime listener of the show, I have been clamoring for like 2 years now. So I was kind of like, hey, look at that kismet. So I guess you watched it last night, right?
Yes.
And I watched it like on Wednesday. But this movie's a doozy. I don't know where to start. It has a history. It has a past. I have personal anecdotes about it. What was your introduction to Hercules?
So I don't know if I saw this movie first or if I actually watched the cartoon first, because they
shockingly
had like
good the cartoon.
Yeah, they had like an on TV cartoon. Mm-hmm. And I really liked it.
Very cheaply made, like animated.
Yeah.
But it was rather sharp and a stellar, like stunning voice cast.
Yeah. I actually really only remember there's an episode with Icarus, I think.
He's the second lead.
Yeah. I remember specifically that, but I don't remember a ton about it. I just remember that I watched it and I really liked it. But I don't remember if I saw this movie like in the theater or not. I just like sort of it's one of those things that I don't remember not remembering it. Mm-hmm. And I've always really liked it. I always really liked the Muses. I always really liked Hercules himself. The whole nine yards. I really love this movie.
This came out, it was summer of 97, which was a summer for me, at least, certainly our generation, because I think a month before or after we got Batman and Robin, and I was like, we got several things, which we've said several times, and we should really go ahead and do Batman and Robin, but that movie is a fantastic kids movie.
Oh, for sure.
If you are looking at it solely as like a children's superhero film, can't be beat. Children love it.
Yeah.
And it's evergreen in that. Like, I've talked to children, you know, now who love it. So
Look, I'm also aware that it's bad, but I love it.
Mm-hmm. There's a YouTube scholar. I can't think of his name. I wasn't being shady when I said that. He's like, he's very, very smart. But he did this whole breakdown on how the movie is not that bad. It really is actually pretty good. If you can get over the cheesiness of it.
Sure.
But yes, this was the summer I turned 12 and it was perfect. I had discovered Greek mythology a year prior, maybe two. The live action TV show Hercules launched in 95.
Mm.
There was a couple of things happening around this point, and I remembered there was a preview for it for Disney's Hercules on the Toy Story VHS.
Interesting.
And so
that's an old fashioned sentence.
Long ago, in the faraway land of ancient Greece, there was a golden age of powerful gods and extraordinary heroes. And the greatest and strongest of all these heroes was the mighty Hercules.
Get your sword!
The hero's only as good as his weapon.
Summer, Walt Disney Pictures presents a comedy of epic proportion.
Ah, yes! I like it!
Hercules.
We dance, we kiss, we schmooze, we carry on, we go home happy. What do you say?
I was thrown into like Glee a full year before it came out.
Wow.
I can remember so much of it is burned. Like the trailer edit is burned into my brain.
Nice.
Like sometimes even more so than the movie itself. But I saw it in theaters. I remember really loving it. And I did some research into the fandom, and there's a big issue with the fact with a lot of people with the fact that it is not mythologically accurate.
Oh, yeah. And it's like aggressively not accurate.
I remember noting that at 12. Like, I remember being proud of the fact I knew.
Yeah.
What was real. But it didn't chafe me the way it chafed a lot of people.
No, it doesn't chafe me at all. I know that it's wrong, but I also don't care. It's not about that.
The Disney animated movies are all based on pre-existing stories, you know, fairy tales, fables, mythology, whatever. And for the most part, a lot of them follow pretty well, pretty much with the plot.
Mm-hmm.
But I do feel like the more we got into the 90s and especially today, they're very loosely like Frozen is only the suggestion of the Snow Queen.
Yeah.
There's so little about the actual mythology in that movie. And so in that regard, I think Hercules was a little bit ahead of its time.
I mean, a little bit, but also, I mean, Greek mythology is, you know, rife with stuff that's really hard to condense for a child.
Yeah.
Like, do you really want, like, weird psychosexual politics with Hera and Zeus?
Yeah, there's a lot of stuff, but also in 90 minutes, as much as you can in 90 minutes, it is sort of an encapsulation of all of Greek mythology that we're just centering around the figure of Hercules.
Sure.
Like, Hercules has stories which are only suggested mm-hmm. in this movie. Like, there's the Hydra, which is an actual proper scene in the movie. There's mm-hmm. the Nemean lion. There's the Stymphalian birds. There's Cerberus. So it's like there's subtle nods, but they have nothing to do with the actual story.
Right.
We begin with the Titanomachy, which mm-hmm. is ambitious.
Yeah.
And then and then this finale is nothing. That's not a thing anywhere. It's the most similar to Cupid and Psyche.
It was a little bit of Orpheus and Eurydice as well.
Yes, 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 yes. And true to form, us going straight to the end, I don't understand why they would go the Cupid and Psyche direction and then not do it, because there's no excuse why Meg wouldn't be welcomed into Olympus. Like,
right.
And that's what happens with Cupid and Psyche. Aphrodite literally gives her butterfly wings and she's welcomed into the fold. And so it's like there's a handful of decisions this movie makes that I think are baffling, considering that I love this movie.
Well, so I, if in that instance, I sort of feel like it has to be kind of a like you didn't actually need the thing that you were searching for. You had it all along. You had your family like back where you were and like that kind of thing. But I agree with you that mythologically it's a little ridiculous. But I think in Disney, they're always trying to tell you a moral or learn you a lesson or something. And so I feel like that's kind of like the journey that you were on was, you know, the friends you met along the way or whatever.
This movie is extremely topical. It's a very mid to late 90s.
Yeah.
And I was
especially all the merch.
Yeah. I was bracing for it to have aged poorer than I think it did. I think, though it's obvious, like the Air Hercs are Air Jordans, it's not like he was pumping them up. Like, it's like you don't actually have to have knowledge of the time period for some of the jokes to work.
Yeah.
And so in a weird way, it's about fame and celebrity. And they're using the language of mythology to make a very modern point, which makes a lot of sense because, like, the Greek version of a hero is not our modern understanding of a hero.
Right.
Like, our modern understanding of a hero is Superman. Mm-hmm. And the Greek version of a hero is more like a famous person.
Mm-hmm.
Like, a lot of heroes were not great. I mean, they tended to do great feats, but
they were like
there's
not
a lot
great
of
people.
Fault and tragedy in a lot of hero stories, namely Hercules. Look it up if you haven't. To take Greek mythology and the character of Hercules to do sort of a send up celebration satire, like, of modern culture and celebrity and stuff, because you reach a point in the movie where the movie is very meta. I mean, and I'm not just talking about the muses, you know, breaking the fourth wall, but it's like it's self-referential in a lot of ways. And I did a lot of research into it because I was and frankly, a lot of this I knew because I was obsessed with it when I was younger. But the basic background story with this stuff was the directors were Ron Clemens and John Musker, and they had directed The Little Mermaid and Aladdin and The Rescuers, I think, which The Rescuers is kind of The Little Mermaid is regarded as the beginning of the Renaissance, but it was able to do so on the springboard that The Rescuers laid out.
Yeah, I remember The Rescuers was like my movie. We watched, my mom and I watched The Rescuers constantly when I was little.
I definitely saw it. It wasn't one of my, it wasn't quite glamorous. Like, I, if anything, no, I'm thinking of The Great Mouse Detective.
They're a little different, but The Rescuers is a bit darker. It's not very, I mean, the one little mouse is, she has like a fur coat or whatever. Mm-hmm. But
the Zsa Zsa Gabor mouse.
Yeah, it's not like very classy.
But yeah, so they wanted to do Treasure Planet. They had this insanely ambitious idea for Treasure Island set in space. And Disney kept being like, I don't know. And the Disney's biggest issue with it was they didn't really think it was marketable. They didn't think there were merchandising opportunities for it.
Sometimes Disney is so short-sighted.
It's so their own biggest
enemy. Well, they
enemy.
Just are like they own- are absolutely the like best at merchandising, and for them to be like, I just don't see the merchandising opportunities. It's like, well, did you think about it for more than 3 seconds?
Well, I mean, the elephant in the room with this is that Treasure Planet, they did do it and it did fail colossally, and the
but
merchandising was not there. I haven't seen it.
Oh, which, I think Will made me watch it.
I've heard it's good. It's like both it and Atlantis were, I think, about 10 years ahead of their time. I think if they came out now, because Disney movies now were PG. Tangled, Frozen, Moana, like where we've evolved. And so I think I would say they were ahead of their time. But basically, Disney kept telling Ron and John, they were like, no, do this first and do this first. And they had to keep proving themselves.
It sounds
and
like so Darren finally, Bousman, honestly.
Yeah. Finally, they were given Hercules and they were basically told to make a 4-quadrant hit. And they were like, it has to be funny. It has to be sad. It has to be exciting. It has to be scary. Like, it had to be everything.
Sure.
And that's so hard to do, especially when your directive is to do that.
Mm-hmm.
Like, if something organically has everything in it, it's one thing. But it's like to engineer that is really difficult. And so they basically threw everything in the kitchen sink at this. And I don't know how intentional it is on their part, but I think the movie itself is sort of ever so slightly snide, like shading Disney.
Oh, I can see that for sure.
With the corporate messaging and stuff.
Yeah.
The Hercules store and all of that.
Definitely.
Even the Herculade. And yeah, it just like. So this movie came out and it wickedly underperformed. And people don't really know why.
Seems bonkers to me.
Yeah, it just sort of got swept under the rug. And it has been considered kind of like a redheaded stepchild for a long time.
Man, and it's wild when I don't know about these fandoms because I have just always loved this movie and just assumed everyone else did too.
Well, it's one of those where it's like for our generation, it's like a cult hit.
Okay.
I mean, there's plenty of Disney movies. We talked about Sleeping Beauty almost bankrupted the company. It's
she
only became profitable in the long run.
Yeah.
And so they're still not entirely sure what happened with Hercules. And now I can't quite remember. I think that there were several other family movies out at the same time. I mean, I mentioned Batman and Robin, but it just didn't hit. Like I said, it just sort of got swept under the rug. And the people I always assumed, because I had the memory of it not doing well. I think this was around about the time I started reading Entertainment Weekly. And so I just assumed I only liked it because of the Greek mythology elements.
Interesting. I mean, the music, there's just nothing but bops, though.
So good.
It's so good.
The meat and potatoes of it all is that as an actual story, if you're looking at this, which is what it is, a plot as a means to an end, as all that, it's actually a very, very weak story and it's messy. There's a lot of plot holes. There's a lot of inconsistencies. There's a neat and tidy little metaphor for this movie right in the middle of the first act.
Mm-hmm.
And it's when Hercules and his father go to the market and he accidentally knocks over the column, the columns, and they're like pinball or like bowling pins.
Yeah.
They're like collapsing. And it's incongruous. He starts at the round part of the horseshoe and is going to the like legs of the horseshoe. But then when we get to the legs of them, it's back at the round part. And I noticed it immediately. I've always noticed it. I just thought, oh, well, it's a gaffe. But it's like that's kind of what the movie as a whole is like. There's things that if you just take it at face value, it's like fine, it works, but it doesn't really make sense. Like,
sure.
Why does Hades have that potion?
Yeah.
Where did it come from? Why didn't he use it before?
Yeah.
You know, on Zeus, how would Hades, the Lord of the Dead, not know Hercules was not dead?
Still alive, like, right?
Why, if Zeus was able to overthrow the Titans single-handedly, why can he not now? Like, why would the planets aligning have anything to do with? I don't know if it's that they didn't care or I don't know how there were so many inconsistencies, because even I mean, towards the end, when like Hercules is like reaching into the river Styx, it's like a foot below him. And then in the very next scene, he has to dive 20 feet into it. Like, there's just weird, like, incongruities throughout the whole movie that if you're really examining it, they're there and they don't work. But the issue I've always had is that I didn't care. I was enjoying everything else it was doing.
Yeah.
And so I think this is one of the sum of the parts is worth more than the whole.
Sure.
And so, yeah. Did you have anything you wanted to say or anything coming out? Like you rewatched it yesterday. Did you have anything that you wanted to?
I mean, nothing like new really jumped out to me than I had, you know, ever really known or loved about it, to the point that honestly, I didn't even none of the like issues you just said, like about him diving in the river Styx. I've literally never even noticed that.
It's bothered me since I was 12.
No,
but
I mean, it's fair. The thing that always bothered me the most is how quickly Meg is going down. Like, the rest of them are really spinning on the surface a lot, and Meg is, like, straight to the bottom. So that was always kind of weird to me, but no, it's never, I don't know, I just, I really liked it. I think, I agree with you about all the plot holes with Hades, because it's also, I mean, in the first place, he's one of the best Disney villains, just because he's hilarious and pretty amazing. It bums me out so hard because it's James Woods, who is a total nut job now.
But his performance is as good as James Woods is terrible. So
yeah, 100%. 100%.
I'm completely fine with separating the art from the artist in this and just not even discussing James Woods.
Yeah. It's like, to me, it's on the level of Jeremy Irons as Scar.
I would even go as far as to say Robin Williams as the genie.
Yeah, 100%.
I would say even a little bit better because I think the James Woods stuff ages slightly better. Robin Williams' material is very dated. It's very
a lot of
its time.
It is. Yeah. Yeah.
No, it absolutely is. I was going to say unparalleled, but we just said it was paralleled.
We just paralleled it to a couple things. One thing that I did actually notice yesterday that I hadn't really noticed before is that I actually find the Meg and Hercules stuff pretty realistic because we see quite a passage of time. So it's like when they finally admit they love each other, it's been weeks, if not months.
Well, we have no way of knowing. Yeah.
Well, it's like however long it took him to do all his trials, you know? And so it's like, I appreciate that much more than so many of these things where they're like, it's been 3 days. I can't live without you.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know. I quite liked that in a way that has not hit me watching this in the past.
Well, you said it. So let's go here. Do you want to talk about Meg?
Yeah. Always.
She is an anomaly in the Disney canon.
Yeah.
She is presumably older than him. Like, I would say easily pushing 30.
Yeah, yeah.
She has a past.
Mm-hmm.
She's self-aware.
I think it's worth noting that she has a sexual past.
I was literally going to say she is the only female Disney character that is openly sexual and a villain. You know what I mean?
Yep.
And she does start from a villainous place, but
I mean, she starts from a very like self-satisfying place where she's like in it for her.
Well, she also owes Hades. Let's go ahead and call the spade the spade. Hades is her pimp.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
It's a pretty blatant dynamic.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
He's definitely between a pimp and like an abusive gay best friend. Like,
yeah, I mean,
because their dynamic is very like fag hag. Like,
I get that impression for sure.
And that's impressive to pull that off.
Yeah. In a children's movie.
Yeah. Which how this has any right claiming that it's rated G?
Is it really?
It's not PG. It is rated G. This movie is graphic.
Yeah.
There is viscera. There is sexual innuendos. Mm-hmm. There is it is dark. I mean, Meg is crushed by a column.
That was something that I noticed as well yesterday. And after I claimed I didn't notice anything new this time. No, I did notice that too. I was like, shit, that's like a really tough death. That's like really tough.
Yeah.
Like literally smushed to death.
How it gets off being rated G, I mean, I have no idea. And it just goes to show you that I think a lot of times we've been talking about this a lot lately, like movies that were misunderstood in their initial run. I think people were just asleep at the wheel. Like, to go back to Meg, I have no idea how she slipped through into this movie.
Yeah.
And Susan Egan is her voice actress. And in case you were wondering, she looks amazing still.
Really? Nice.
Just as good.
Cool.
She was on Encore, that Disney Plus show.
Oh, sure. Okay.
She was the original Belle for Broadway, and she's done lots of stuff here and there, but it's like, it's just so iconic considering that the movie isn't. Because it's like, my brother came home while I was watching this, and it was right when Hercules and Meg meet, and as she's like leaving, and Andrew like pantomimed with her the like, it's been a real slice.
Oh, like, sure.
Well, thanks for everything, Herc. It's been a real slice.
And it's very shocking to me how sophisticated she is and their dynamic is.
Yeah, I was going to say, given the fact that you told me that they did Treasure Planet as well, I think there are a lot of similar female characters in Treasure Planet.
Okay.
Yeah, because I think that's what they were probably hoping to usher in with this batch of movies that all happen right there. I mean, because we discussed at a certain point doing The Emperor's New Groove with this. And while that is really a lot more of a buddy movie. Oh, God, I forgot her name. Wendy something.
Well, Wendy Malick.
Wendy Malick is the wife, and she is not like a normal Disney movie wife. And then Yzma is obviously the total polar opposite, and though she is a villain, but it's sort of like there are all these Disney movies kind of right at the same time that have this type of woman in them. And mm-hmm. that is really interesting now that I'm thinking about them all connected to each other.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Hercules is fairly boring in this. And that's another thing people I saw people were criticizing. And I think it's fine. I think it's fine to have a show about Archie Andrews and mm-hmm. have him be the least interesting character and populate it with like characters around him.
That's
you know?
Absolutely the thing that we talk about so much, which is, are you the most boring person around? You're probably the lead character.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't think there's anything wrong with that. And I mean, adding to that, the fact that it's Tate Donovan really giving it his all in this voice performance is just like, it makes him so cute and charming. And like, who doesn't love Hercules?
I completely agree. And I guess it's one of those polarizing things that like, there are people who think like, good guys with a heart of like the golden retriever is boring. And I'm like,
I mean, I think he can be boring.
Because I also love what a fucking virgin Hercules is in this movie.
So much.
So, and they more like on like four different occasions, they find a way to sexualize him. Uh-huh. Like they find a way to like pull his top down.
Yep.
And he's always like grasping, like trying to cover himself.
Well, he's always like being after he gets like buff and he's been doing all of his hero trials and everything. He keeps on getting like mobbed by groups of women.
He's ogled and he's so uncomfortable by it. It's so funny. Even just the Meg, like all of her stuff and their scene, like, okay. There's still so much I want to talk about. I do want to talk about the music. And I, like I said, I did a lot of research. I watched a lot of videos. I watched a lot of first parts of videos and then bailed out because I was not interested. Because one of them, this person was like, I don't remember if it was a guy or girl, but they were talking about how the music was weird and didn't make sense. And I was like, I'm sorry, gospel music? And a Greek myth is a stroke of genius.
Well, not even that, but like actually how many people do you legitimately think in a real world situation would have been like, we need a Greek chorus? Nobody. Literally nobody would have thought of that. And to have
Woody Allen
to
have and Mighty them, Aphrodite, and that's
well,
it.
Okay, but let's leave that let's leave that out of
we'll
this
put
conversation.
That with James Woods.
First of all, it's a Greek chorus, which is standard in Greek stories like this. Second of all, they're muses, which is a great way to bring in another facet of Greek mythology. And third of all, it's gospel music, which is fucking hilarious. It's amazing. It's so good.
Exquisite.
And it's hilarious.
Like it's so well done. And the fact that because they did pare it down to five muses, which is understandable. From nine is a lot.
Yeah.
They each have unique identities and personalities that we understand, mm-hmm. especially by the end. And this is disgusting, but they are the first named black characters in a Disney animated movie since Fantasia. And the less said about that, the better.
So, okay, I have a couple of questions. We can talk about it off if you really don't want to talk about it. Who are the named black characters in Fantasia?
The centaur that was edited out.
They have names?
The one centaur that was like, it was like the mammy centaur. Do you remember? I showed her to you.
Yeah.
She's been edited out, but she had a name. I don't remember what it was.
Oh, okay.
But she was like the maid to the other centaurs.
Yeah. I know. It's very problematic and not great, but I just didn't, because do the rest of them have names?
The muses?
No.
Oh,
the other centaurs.
I mean, you're focusing on the wrong part of this.
No, I know. I'm just like, you threw me for a loop with that
she
one.
She had a name. I don't remember what it was. I mean, I can look it up if you want me to.
No, I'm sure it's inappropriate. That's so crazy to me that they're, oh God, 1997. That's horrible.
Yeah.
Yikes.
And even the muses, I think it could be lost on some people that they're.
Oh, for sure.
So,
yeah.
The voice actresses are, they did do, and this was always, oh my God, I am still trying to have like five different conversations. I don't want to get to the live action remake yet, but I do want to say when we do get to it and when we do this, this is one of the rare instances where I do want it to be shot for shot. Because there's choreography in this, like doable, danceable mm-hmm. choreography in this animated movie. And all of the muses scenes, they had actresses in those costumes dancing them as reference mm-hmm. and stuff. There's phenomenal footage of it on YouTube.
Yeah.
And this does get me back to where I was getting to, which is this is a bold statement. Some might find this a bold statement. I think it goes without question. But in a soundtrack that is full of bops, I think easily the standout is I Won't Say I'm in Love.
Oh, 100%.
Okay, you're there with me.
If there's a prize for rotten judgment, I guess I've already won that. No man is worth the aggravation. That's ancient history, been there, done that.
Who'd you think you're kidding? He's the earth and heaven to you. Try to keep it hidden. Honey, we can see right through you. Girl, you can't conceive it. We know how you're feeling. Who you're thinking of.
No chance, no way, I won't say you don't know.
You're smooth.
No, I'm 100% there with you. And actually, I was just looking at the trivia because I think Alan Menken actually wrote it.
Mm-hmm.
Because it was a different song originally. Yeah, okay. Meg was originally given a ballad titled I Can't Believe My Heart, but Ken Duncan, the supervising animator of Meg, pointed out that the song was out of character. Mm-hmm. So Alan Menken and Dave Zippel would later compose I Won't Say I'm in Love instead. And it is absolutely... I mean, I love... I Can Go the Distance. It's like, it gets me emotional every single time, but
it's
I won't
standard,
say
standard though.
It's a Hunter. It's a, his like standard. I wish want. Song 100%. But I Won't Say I'm in Love is the Let It Go of Hercules.
It is. It's doo-wop. And when they retooled the song to fit her character, that's when they brought the muses into it. Originally, it was just a solo.
Mm.
And that is something that if we do musical with this live action, there needs to be at least three more songs and the muses need to be in it.
Yeah, 100%. That's the thing. If they make this movie, if they do, like, and obviously we haven't seen the live action Mulan yet, so we can't actually comment on it. But if they try to take the music out of this movie... It's gonna be a problem.
It's just another Hercules movie.
Which we've had like four since this one, and they've all been trash.
This movie has such an identity. First of all, it has a explicit visual identity, borderline shocking. That's one of the reasons why a lot of critics didn't like it at first, is they called it cheap. And I'm just kind of like, bitch, where?
Well, I don't think it's cheap. I think it's weirdly... designed like Greek art.
It is.
It's very simplistic in that way, but I would never say cheap.
It's also, it's Gerald Scarfe is the artist. He's the one who did the Pink Floyd, the wall and all that stuff. He does very grotesque caricatures and stuff. And Hercules, Hades, and Nessus, the river god, are pretty much verbatim. He just designed them and their looks didn't change.
Wow.
That's why they're so strange, like the bridges of their nose and the chins and stuff. And
interesting.
I mean, this movie has like swirling spiral nipples. It's like, that's just not something that you see, let alone in a Disney movie. You know what I mean?
Not often.
Like, and then to go with the music and the tone and stuff, it's like the I Won't Say I'm in Love. For me, that's one of the rare Disney songs where not only is it so iconic in the movie and so necessary to its movie, but it can exist outside of its movie.
Mm-hmm.
Like Soka, like someone could just cover that and be singing it in, you know, a park, and you wouldn't be like, ah, yes. I mean, you would say, ah, yes, Hercules, but it's like, I would compare it to Kiss the Girl, where it's like, that's actually just like a pop song. You know what I mean?
No, 100%. And I also think it is one of the more sophisticated Disney love songs.
Mm-hmm.
Because she's...
it's ironic.
It's a little ironic. She's also like, while claiming she won't say it, she is clearly admitting that she is in love with him, but it like goes against her brand. And it's like, it's funny. And I mean... does Susan Egan do the singing voice as well?
Oh, yeah. This was very difficult for her because she's classically trained. She's a Broadway person. And the women who were the muses are gospel singers. And that's largely learned. Like, it's largely organic and improvised and stuff. And so she had to actually do, like, training with them to be able to, like, actually blend with them.
Yeah.
They talked about it, one of the behind-the-scenes things. It was really interesting. But
well, it's amazing. She does a great job.
Yeah. And... I do think Zero to Hero Because you're right, Go the Distance is good, but for me, it is just so standard. So I think Zero to Hero is probably my favorite. I don't think I've ever said the phrase Hercules thinking about Disney's version and not gone down.
Bless my soul, Herc was on a roll.
Person of the week in every Greek opinion poll.
What a pro, Herc could stop a show.
Point him at a monster and you're talking SRO.
He was a no one.
That sequence, it's so frantic.
Mm-hmm.
It's like charging off the rails. It never fully gets off the rails, though. It's such a perfect encapsulation of that part of the plot. And so it's like, you know, sure, this plot is messy and has holes in it and stuff. But if you just go with it, it knows where it's going and it gets you there and it stays there. So it's like, on one hand, you could call the plot messy and not there. And another, it's like, I don't know, catch up. Like, it goes back to the, I can't think of her actual name. It's like Momo O'Brien or something on Twitter when she was talking about Andrew Lloyd Webber's Cats. And she was like, use your imagination. Like, you're doing it, Peter. Like, you know what I mean? It's like, just suspend disbelief and fucking watch the movie. Like,
sure.
I did want to talk a little bit more about the style, the animation and stuff. Because I pulled up a review and it was one of the reviews that from the time that was talking about how it looked cheap, which, again, I don't understand. They were talking about how lazy and uninspired Olympus was, which, I mean, it's pretty standard. It's pretty kind of what you would get. But you can pause at any moment in Olympus and identify every detail. Who the gods are, what the relics are, what the it is littered with Easter eggs. And the gods have such visual identities. I remember being 12 and being like knowing who they were.
I was going to say, I guess that doesn't directly relate to whether or not it looks cheap. But I feel like being able to identify all of that stuff has to mean something. It has to say something in your favor. And you're right. Every single god or goddess that's up there, you can tell who they are because they have like the one specific thing about them that you're supposed to see when you see the Greek gods.
Well, it's shorthand, but it's like they basically use color, shape, and dress, like symbolism and stuff.
Yeah.
Because you can literally tell the difference between Demeter and Persephone because Demeter's plumper and Persephone has daisy petal crowns.
Yeah.
Like a daisy petal crown. And it's like, we know Persephone was picking a daisy. Do you know what I mean? Like, it just, they could have so easily just had faceless background characters in togas. And they
animated every single one of them.
And there's visual gags with them. I mean, with Hermes, with Hephaestus, with Aphrodite. I mean, Aphrodite, she doesn't speak, but she's very present in this movie.
Well, and that's the other thing, too. You literally just said Hephaestus. Like, when do you ever see a Greek god movie actually represent Hephaestus? And he's there and he's making lightning bolts for Zeus. I mean, that's a thing that I feel like you have to recognize in this scenario for sure.
I love the depiction of Ares. He's like grumpy. He's like an angry dwarf man.
Yeah.
That's just such a take. And yeah, I love it. I love it so much. I honestly, this might be controversial. I like Danny DeVito.
No, Danny DeVito's great.
I like Phil in this. Yeah. Like, I think he's funny. I think I do like the kind of lazy, slightly dated New York comparison.
Mm.
Like comparing Thebes to New York. And there's a lot of like Yiddish and stuff in it. And I do kind of like all that. I want to talk about Pegasus. That is another thing that people are weirdly butthurt about because Pegasus does not coexist with Hercules.
Oh, who gives a shit? Jesus, it's, people, what more do you want?
It's such an iconic design and it's such an iconic performance. Pegasus is such a character. I think he belongs in like the annals of sidekickery.
Well, he's just very like, you know, Prince Philip's horse from Sleeping Beauty and like Maximus from Tangled. I mean, there's a long line of the heroes of movies having sort of like animal sidekicks. Or yeah, like dick horses. And he's just another one, and I just don't, because he hates Meg, and I think that's hilarious. I don't know, man. The people, you're making me crabby. All these people are so fucking butthurt.
No, and that's never my intention when I do this. For me, I'm looking for talking points. It's like sometimes if you give me a starting point, then I have like a springboard, like sure. A place to go where, like, if you were to say, I think this is bad, I can be like, well, it's good and here's why, mm-hmm. You know, and even just the mohawk on Pegasus, like, why is it blue? It's awesome. And do you see Pegasus merchandise? Like,
yeah.
There should be.
I've seen it sometimes.
Some, because remember, yeah. I had the baby Pegasus stuffed animal, but mm-hmm. I mean, I got it the summer of 97, so.
That's true. You don't see it a lot anymore.
Yeah, I ultimately think it has a good message. It has a sophisticated message. I don't quite think it sticks the landing. I think it does a good enough job explaining the difference between fame and heroism. That mm-hmm. there, and maybe this is a place where it is also a little bit ahead of its time, because celebrity evolved so much more, and the type of celebrity depicted in this movie, dated jokes aside, is more prominent now.
Definitely.
I think it's there, and I think if you can get over the arbitrary MacGuffin-y stuff about mm-hmm. like why Zeus can't just decree things, you know what right. I mean?
Well, I mean, again, that's sort of a, like, you have to go on the journey to learn the lesson mm-hmm. kind of thing. It's like, why did the eagles just take the ring to Mordor? And it's like, you have to walk there. It's just, you have to.
And it is a little bit undercut by the end, because Hercules does just break his deal with Hades. Like, so I don't know. I mean, but.
Well, no, because Meg explains that. She said he promised I wouldn't get hurt. And so when she gets smushed by the column, it makes the deal void.
Okay.
I remember very specifically, because I sort of forgotten it from before.
I don't know. I mean, this has Bobcat Goldthwait in it, mm-hmm. and that is dangerous.
Yeah,
a large Bobcat Goldthwait performance from a movie in 1997. Mm-hmm. And I think it works.
He's one of the little gremlins, right?
Yeah, Pain and Panic. So, yeah, I do want this live action movie. The Russo brothers apparently are producing it. There is not a director, but I still feel confident with them at the helm. And so far, they have expressed a little bit of self-awareness about it. I think they have a passion for it.
Okay.
They posted a tweet and it said us right now, and it was Pain and Panic looking nervous. So
that's solid.
All in. This is a musical. So it has to be a musical, and not like, I mean, as much as we liked The Greatest Showman at face value, it's like, what musical did we see recently that we were really praising?
Recently? God, I don't know.
Maybe I'm thinking of Cats, because I liked the fact that there were the different sets and the different camera, like stuff like that. So Cats, I'm not trying to bring that up here. That's not.
No. I mean, as for immersion.
Yeah.
I think Cats did a good job at immersing you in the world.
Mm-hmm.
For sure.
But yes, I mean, I want the muses. First of all, we already said you have to have the muses. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of really stunty casting going around the internet. And I think it actually could work and would be a good idea, because frankly, the muses' entire role can be done on a green screen.
Yeah.
So it's like, if you're trying to pull in big names like Beyonce or Lizzo or Janelle Monáe.
Oh my God. Like, yes, all three.
Had you not seen that? Yeah.
I hadn't seen that. The only one I saw weirdly was Amber Riley. And that's why I texted you the other day. I was like, are we still all in on the Glee kids?
She's kind of a thing. I mean, she was on Dancing with the Stars. I remember she was in the Little Mermaid that they did with Ali'i.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
But yeah, I think, well, Beyonce is as the head is Calliope, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. and Janelle Monáe as the one on the right.
With the amazing hair.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then Lizzo as the big one. Like, yeah, I think. And
100%. I'm down for all that.
With like SZA, or, I mean, even a Cardi B somewhere. It's like,
mm-hmm.
But you could do, depending on, you know, the schedules and stuff, you could film their scenes in like a week.
Mm-hmm.
Just green screen.
I'm curious, because one of the things that I do really like about this movie too, is that it has the Fates in it.
Mm-hmm.
But I would be curious how they, because I feel like you have to glam them up a little.
I mean, you could go Tina Fey, Amy Poehler, Maya Rudolph, like.
Oh, shit. You sure could.
It depends on how stunty you're trying to be with the cast.
Right. Yeah.
I have been passionate about this for a while because I have several, but my picks for Zeus and Hera is The Rock and Kerry Washington.
Ooh. Yeah, all right.
I mean, you could throw like Jeff Bridges or Kurt Russell in there, but I kind of like buff, like yeah. Daddy Zeus.
No, yeah. I and agree for sure.
You could throw in Nicole Kidman or Michelle Pfeiffer, but they've both kind of just done that type of a role.
Something very similar, yeah. Mm-hmm. I'm still kind of married to Noah Centineo as Hercules, who you said you had someone different the other day.
Noah was always my pick. The casting all depends on Hercules.
100%.
And unless they're going to make the age difference more, mm-hmm. like from 10 to 25, mm-hmm. I would want the same human. Because he's as it's written, he goes from like 15 to 18. And it's like,
sure.
You know what I mean? That doesn't work. I already mentioned KJ Apa, you know, it's like, I don't know if or how you would bulk him up.
Yeah, I feel like he's kind of, I think he doesn't need to get bigger. He's like, for me, he's like at max capacity right now.
And again, if you want to go a little bit older, it's like you can go Zac Efron, but he's like, he's dangerous of like aging out of this.
Yeah, he's pretty far over. And also he has said that he will never get in Baywatch shape again. So I don't know that that's in our cards either.
If it were me, obviously I'd scale older and I'd have kind of Zac Efron and maybe like an Aubrey Plaza type for Meg, because we know she can sex it up when she needs to.
Sure.
And she's got the quirky, like the sassy, like offbeat down.
Yeah.
Pat. People are really married to Ariana Grande. I get
too young.
It.
She's
not going to fight it. It's hers to take or leave. Do you know what I mean? After she did that, a lot of people think that this was in the works sooner and that her sing-along that she did 2 weeks ago was kind of a audition.
I kind of hope she leaves it. I don't know. I don't love it, especially definitely not with Noah Centineo.
Well, that's what I mean. It's like, yeah, if we got her, I would be fine with it. I mean, she's got the ponytail. She's got a lot of it down pat already. But
anyone can have a ponytail, Will. You think they're going to use her real hair for this?
Well, I saw the girl. She doesn't even have real hair. What do you?
Exactly. Exactly.
I saw, and I don't know her name, but I saw some pictures of one of the girls from the current CW dynasty.
Oh, okay.
She had a good face and a good look and that kind of gingery hair, like ginger brown hair. And again, he's like on the older side at 30, but it's like a Taron Egerton type. Like,
Yeah.
So
I don't know. Nobody in the real world is going to get those calves.
Well, and then furthermore, how hellish do we want to make this visually? Do you know what
sure.
I mean?
Like, yeah.
Because if they go for it, I mean, a movie I bring up frequently when I'm talking about stylization, I mean, Sin City went places, you know, mm-hmm. like you could do it in a way that I just don't trust Disney will do with a live action, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But then again, it's like this is the kind of movie that I think that the live action treatment should be for. It's like a movie that kind of like not necessarily flopped, but it's like is worth revisiting. Do you know what I mean?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Especially now that everybody and their mother has Disney Plus.
Mm-hmm.
Just go do it.
I think for Hades, there's a lot of places you could take it, honestly. Yeah. Vince Vaughn.
Ooh, that's
Richard
a good one.
E. Grant.
Oh, yeah, Richard E. Grant could be pretty good, for sure.
Either Tom Hiddleston or Cumberbatch.
Cumberbatch is fine. I resist Hiddleston just because he's already a Disney villain.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like, how bad do you want to...
Mm-hmm.
I mean, he would be amazing. He's amazing at everything, but I resist... I mean, I don't. I'm the one that doesn't like that Zoe Saldana is in three different space franchises.
Yeah. No, I was just throwing out people that I think could do the role because it's like I also don't think this cast would align. It's too loaded. You know what I mean?
That's true. That's also true. Yeah.
Although I do have Margot Martindale as Alcamene.
Oh my God, yeah, I'm for it.
You don't need Amphitryon. He doesn't need to be there.
I just love Margot Martindale. She's so amazing.
Rounding out my Olympus, I had John Mulaney as Hermes.
Oh, that would be very good.
And I think you need Aphrodite, even though she doesn't even speak. Like I said, she's got a lot of bits. And I was like, honestly, this is a little bit 4 years ago, 5 years ago, but like a Kate Upton type would be a good.
Yeah, yeah. Dundee. Well, Kate Upton, I think, is still relatively unproblematic. She could do it.
Well, because like I said, she just needs to like be pouty and flirty, and she's got the shape, you know, the bombshell. Her face already looks like a heart. Yeah. And I was like, because I initially was like, it's too bad she's too old, and I looked her up and she's 27. So I was like, yikes.
Yeah, she's fine. She's fine.
But, you know, just that kind of stunty type mm-hmm. casting is what I think. And then I don't have anything too inspired for Pain and Panic. I just, the most obvious thing that came to mind, because it's like, I don't think you should be copying. Like, I don't think you should be parodying or mimicking what came before. I think you should find something with a similar vibe in a different space. So I would go with a duo like a Key and Peele type of a situation.
Sure. Yeah. I mean, they nailed Ducky and Bunny. So,
yeah. You know, so it's a shame Keenan and Kel still aren't a thing. But
Oh, man.
But yeah, so I think that if they actually go for it, if they find people who are, because that's another thing in Ariana's plus column, is she's actually very passionate about it.
I mean, that's fair. I would just, I don't know. I was going to just say, do we know if she can act? And I was like, I know that she was on a Disney Channel show for a long time, but like, can she act?
I'm a little afraid she'll overplay.
That's the, my concern as well. Or yeah.
Cuteness,
we know that she can sing the song. That's not the... We watched her sing I Won't Say I'm in Love. I know mm-hmm. she can do that. I want her to be able to deliver It's Been a Slice.
Or like the scene, it's so funny, but it's the scene when she comes to Hercules and she's like, the kids are trapped under the rock.
Mm-hmm.
And he's like, this is my chance to like mm-hmm. be famous. And she goes, oh, you're really choked up about this, aren't you? Like,
yeah, I don't know that I think Susan Egan had enough like life under her belt at the point she recorded that. That she was like able to get into that part of the character, and despite Ariana Grande's
of a Zendaya type,
sure, yes, like despite Ariana Grande's many travails up to now, I'm not sure she's got that kind of worldliness.
I don't know. Ask Pete Davidson's dick, but
I don't. No, thank you.
On that note, you had to make it dirty.
Oh man.
So yeah. I'm trying to think if there's anything else. Was there another song that we wanted to hit on? Those are the good ones. I mean, they're all good.
Yeah.
But...
yeah, but those three for sure. Mm-hmm. I Can Go the Distance, Zero to Hero, and I Won't Say I'm in Love. Mm-hmm. Those are the ones.
Gonna shout it from the mountaintop. A star is born. Yeah. So
are you gonna let me do my spiel?
Your spiel?
My like end of the episode spiel.
Oh, well, I wasn't. I won't say that I'm done.
Oh, man.
So, okay.
Yeah. As always, you can follow us on Twitter at So I'm Watching, or Instagram at So I'm Watching the Show. We also have a website, soimwatching.com, that links out to everything. We are also doing a couple bonus episodes per week right now. The first one is Penny Dreadful, City of Angels, and the next one coming in the next 2 weeks, I think. We are going to at least give Snowpiercer a try, but we've heard good things about it. And then other than that, you can just rate, review, and subscribe on iTunes or wherever you listen. And that's it for us.
I am on my way. I can go the distance. I don't care how far. Somehow I'll be strong. I know every mile will be worth my while. I would go most anywhere.